Jesus, be the center, be my source, be my light, Jesus. Jesus.
Good morning. It's lovely to see all of you. Sadly, we can't do the peace that we normally do, shake hands. But it's just so wonderful that we're able to meet together, to worship God, and to give thanks to God and to hear His word. Are there any notices? Okay, I have one. So we're all aware, in light of the passing of the Duke of Edinburgh, I think it is fine, or it's wise and the sensible thing to do, to open the church to the public so that people who want to just come and find time to reflect or pray, they can come. So the church is going to be open from tomorrow from 9 to 5. And I would just encourage, if you can, as a member of the congregation, just pop in, because we don't have stewards who can be here throughout that time. But it would be very helpful if any of us who can, once in a while, just pop around, and just to make sure we're just concerned also with the children coming in and vandalizing. So I really appreciate the people who'd be willing to come in between those hours. And I think Jeff has kindly offered, he's happy to help with closing the church. He might talk to Edgar. He will open and Edgar would lock it. So thank you. And I also want to thank Robert and other ministry leadership team who've been very just helpful. I'm not going to be around next week. An email will come. We are going to have a service in commemoration of the Duke next week, Friday at 7:30. Robert is going to send more details to the church administrator. So it'd be just helpful. We don't know how it's going to be like. I don't have all the details, whether the council will be involved. I'm sure the council and the mayor will be involved, but it's just a time of giving the community an opportunity to come and remember and pray together. Penny's going to be leading us, and I'll hand over to Penny. But before I hand over to Penny, can we pray? Dear Father God, we thank you, God, that we can gather together. That we can gather together, Lord, in the power of your Spirit that raised our Savior Jesus Christ from the dead. We thank you, Father, for the life that we experience as a church, that we have that resurrected power within us, Lord. Thank you, Lord God, that Christ Jesus is risen. He's risen indeed, and is here with us right now. So we welcome you, Holy Spirit. Yeah. Just have your way this morning. We don't have any agenda. Our agenda is for King Jesus to be glorified in our midst this morning. For lives to be transformed. Father, we even pray for those people who watch this service, that Lord God, you will speak, you will touch, you will encourage. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen.
Please, would you stand? We're very glad that you're joining us this morning for our service from St. Peter's in Bromyard. Today, as a nation, we're thanking God for the life of Prince Philip, Duke of Edinburgh, for the way he supported the Queen for 73 years of marriage. We're also remembering the Queen and as she grieves for the loss of her husband and for all the royal family. We're going to have 2 minutes silence while you think about the Duke of Edinburgh, pray for him yourselves, and pray for the Queen and the royal family. And also afterwards, I'm going to use the prayers, some of the prayers that have been sent to us from the diocese. Shall we pray? In this moment of sorrow, the Lord is in our midst and consoles us with his word. No eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. Blessed are the sorrowful, for they shall be comforted. Into your hands, O Lord, we humbly entrust our brother Philip, Duke of Edinburgh. In this life you embraced him with your tender love and opened to him the gate of heaven. The old order has passed away as you welcome him into paradise, where there will be no sorrow, no weeping nor pain, but the fullness of peace and joy with your Son and the Holy Spirit forever and ever. Heavenly Father, into whose hands Jesus Christ commended his spirit at the last hour, into those same hands we now commend your servant Philip, that death may be for him the gate to life and to eternal fellowship with you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Most merciful God, whose wisdom is beyond understanding, surround the Queen and the royal family today with your love, that they may not be overwhelmed by their loss, but have confidence in your goodness and strength to meet the days to come. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. How good and pleasant it is when brothers live together in unity. When Thomas met the risen Jesus, he said, "My Lord and my God." After Easter, there are many stories of how Jesus met with different people, how he dealt with them as individuals in different ways. As we move on from Easter, we shall see the start of the early church and how Jesus deals with his followers and sends them out equipped with the power to preach the gospel. We're going to be thinking over the next few weeks about this early church and how Jesus dealt with them. and how Jesus deals with us as individuals. Like Thomas, he deals with us. We are all different, we are all unique and special to him. But we are also all part of one body, his body, the church. And each of us, like Thomas, need to meet him individually. Jesus knows what we all need and the different gifts he wants to give us as part of his body. So today we're coming to worship him. Let him speak to us as Thomas, as he spoke to Thomas, and then fall at his feet and say, "My Lord and my God." Let us pray. Loving God, we come before you in our brokenness and with our fears and apprehensions. We come seeking unity and peace. Bind us together by the power of your Spirit, that strengthened in faith, we may worship you in spirit and in truth. In the name of Christ crucified and risen. Amen.
Amen.
And now we're going to stand and listen to the hymn. And join in if you want to quietly. At your feet we fall, mighty risen Lord. As we come before a mighty God, we realise how much we have failed him and have not been the people that he created us to be. Let us have a short time of silence before we worship at his feet, and then follow it with our confession. So let us at Christ's feet fall as the mighty risen Lord and confess that we have failed him many times. After each sentence, please will you respond with the words, O Lord, forgive. For our insensitivity to the needs of others, O Lord, forgive. For our prejudice and fear that prevent us from loving others, O Lord, forgive. For the narrowness of our vision and our shrinking from your demands, O Lord, forgive. For our resentment against those who have hurt us, O Lord, forgive. For our desire to do your work in our own way, O Lord, forgive. For our impatience with those who are different from us, O Lord, forgive. For our failure to listen properly to other people's point of view, O Lord, forgive. For our fear of coming out of the fortress of our own souls and into your fuller and deeper life, O Lord, forgive. The Lord says, I will bring my people back to me. I will love them with all my heart. No longer am I angry with them. I will be to my people like rain in a dry land. This is the promise of God. Thanks be to God. God offers us the assurance of forgiveness. Lord, we thank you for your patience with us, your acceptance of our doubting and questioning, and your assurance of forgiveness. How many times do we grieve your heart with our lack of belief and exasperate you with our lack of faith? But like a good parent, you gather us to you and answer our misgivings. With you, O Lord, is infinite forgiveness. Amen. Now, as we're still in the Easter season, we're going to listen to a beautiful rendering of the Easter Alleluia, sung by Cassandra and Callahan Star Armstrong. And this was published on the 21st of March 2021, so it's very new. So just close your eyes and think of God speaking to you through these words.
Drink his last and gave his all the glory.
think that's absolutely beautiful. And I thought, we heard it earlier before Easter, and I thought, I'll share that with you today, because it's lovely. Could we have our first reading, please, the psalm? Thank you.
Our first reading is Psalm 133, in praise of brotherly love. How wonderful it is, how pleasant for God's people to live together in harmony. It is like the precious anointing oil running down from Aaron's head and beard, down to the collar of his robes. It is like the dew on Mount Hermon, falling on the hills of Zion. That is where the Lord has promised his blessing, life that never ends. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
As you probably gather, the theme for today is unity. And we're now going to listen, stand, and sing if you can, through your mouths, to the song, Bind Us Together, Lord, with chords that cannot be broken. Please stand.
The second reading is from Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, verses 32-35. All the believers were in one heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all that there was no needy person among them. For from the time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money for the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone who had need. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Penny. Thank you, Jill. It's helpful to have the time so I don't go on for a long time. Time is here. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you, God, that your word has power to transform us. Your word has power to cleanse, to create new hearts within us. Thank you, Lord, that your word is alive. And now, Lord, we ask for your Holy Spirit, just like it came on that day of Pentecost, to come afresh upon us this morning. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen.
Yes, I love the lectionary, because the gospel reading today was a doubting Thomas. And so between Penny and I, we had to decide. Penny was very drawn to go to doubting Thomas, but I just felt drawn. I said, you know what? Yes, I'm going to be preaching to a church who, you guys don't have a problem with the resurrection. We all believe that Jesus is risen. So on that, I said, you know what? We don't, yes, there are times we've doubted, we've questioned, but I believe I'm speaking to a congregation who believe he's risen.
Amen.
And his kingdom is everlasting. But that story for doubting Thomas is very, very important, because we all go through that time. A lot of us, at times, we do have, that's fine. But this morning, just reflecting on the Acts of the Apostles, this passage we've heard, it's very familiar. You know, the Spirit came on Pentecost, miracles, the church was growing. The reality, there was persecution. Just to give you the context of where this text comes, the key thing I want to draw your attention in this few minutes that we have, all believers were one in heart and in mind. They were one in heart and in mind. St. Peter's, are we one in heart and in mind as a body of Christ here in Bromyard? I don't know the answer. I can't answer on your behalf. That is something each one of us ought to ask. Do we believe that we are one in heart and in mind? It goes on to say, no one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. Obviously, their context is different from our context. There's all sorts of things that have been written, commentaries about this. But what I want to draw your attention this morning, it was a challenge to me, is the possessions, the material things we all have, how do I view them? There is a sense it's mine, my Land Rover is mine, my house is mine, my thing is mine. Everything. But we see from this early church that was marked, a church that is filled with the Holy Spirit, there was nothing that this is mine. When there was a need, it was open. We thank God that here in the West, a lot of things, you know, we are blessed. We've got accommodation. It's not that when I walk outside Bromyard, I'll find someone begging for bread or food. We thank God for food bank. But there is still needs in Bromyard. There are still needs. Maybe the needs are not so much needing food. Maybe the need is your time, beloved. Food bank, to be honest, we are well equipped. We're well stocked up. I might be lying. When it comes to food, it's well stocked up. But there is a need still. We can sit here and argue, say, well, we don't have people who are in need of food, of maybe money, because, you know, thank God we've got the universal credits. But beloved, there is still need in Bromyard. And the challenge that I have for us is the time. We can have all sort of excuses. I can't do this, I can't do that. But we can all make time to listen. One of the things I found that Food Bank, or maybe Helen corrects me, CMA, what they need sometimes is just time to listen. And to be honest, I don't know if Rob is here. I didn't plan this. This is not in my text. I want to say thank you to Rob, how you have come alongside David. You have sacrificed your time to come alongside David. Today we have David because someone was so generous with their time. Beloved, I'm asking you, as a congregation, are we one in heart and in mind? Are we helping to facilitate a community that is united? These early church, something that we learned from them, they were united. They had a purpose. There was one. There were three things that I found very challenging here. If you read earlier in chapter 4 at the start, before we get to 32, these are the things that I've observed. We hear that when John and Peter were released after they were being harassed because they were told, don't preach the resurrection in the name of Jesus, don't do that. But they said, no, we will not listen to you, we would rather listen to God. But after that, one of the things that struck me, it said they prayed, they praised the Lord.
Amen.
They were people of praise. This really struck me. They praised the Lord. We hear that they quoted from Acts, they quoted Psalm 2, where they said, when they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer. Guys, how often do we raise our voices together in prayer? We just do it on Sunday. I am going to challenge us. Sorry, when it comes to prayer, a lot of us are reluctant. What I see here is corporate prayer. We don't like corporate prayer. We like individualistic. It's good, but as a church, it's not about putting up a beautiful service. Let's do renovation, let's do that. Prayer is at the heart of what it means to be a body of Christ. So one observation I saw, they were a people of prayer. And the second observation, before we have all this unity, the text we've heard, their prayer was focused on the sovereignty of God. In 28, in Acts chapter 4, verse 28, they acknowledged God as being sovereign. Whatever was happening to them, whatever happened to the Lord Jesus, they said this was planned. God knew this. All the events, God was in control. I want to ask us, do we believe what's happening in your life, in the life of the church, that God is in control? I don't know the answer to that. You have to answer. But for me, I believe whatever is happening in my life, personally, and in the life of the church, God is sovereign. God is in control. None of them takes God by surprise. So there was a people that recognized the sovereignty of God, than wanting to take things in their own hands. And the other thing that struck me from the observation as it builds onto the oneness, they proclaimed the gospel. We heard that the apostles proclaimed the gospel with power. The gospel is the power to salvation. There is no any other thing. It is proclaiming the good news that Jesus came. Jesus kept on saying, I have to proclaim the kingdom of the Father, the kingdom. It's proclamation of the gospel. And then that's when we hear in verse 31, chapter 4, verse 31, they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, spoke the word of God boldly. Remember those observations. Praise God, the servant of God, proclaiming. The Spirit had no choice, the Holy Spirit was there. But in closing, this Spirit-filled community, they had a radical attitude towards their possession. There was an attitude where whatever we have does not belong to us, it belongs to God. I'm not saying that there's a biblical command that we should sell things and give. No, that's not what I'm saying. But there was a sense where they held things loosely. Yes, I have this, but everything I have belongs to God. So there was that radical attitude in particular to their possessions. The other thing I noted was this radical attitude led to a sacrificial action. Sacrificial, not because it suited them, or I will do that when I have time. No, it's a sacrifice. How do you feel when you give? Are you giving because it suits you? Is it just that 10% when actually there is a need? When actually you know that there is a need in our midst, how do we deal with that? Is it just when it suits us? Do you go out of your way to do something for the body of Christ? Beloved, if we're only doing it when it suits us, we need to go back and read the scripture. What I see from the early church, there was sacrificial action. Imagine selling your home. They sold their home because there was a need. That, I don't know how. It's just impossible. I can't even imagine it. But the three things we see that helped in witnessing. I know we've been thinking about mission, the church, how we're going to grow, what's going to happen. But in this text, we see very, very clear, we can't argue. The only way we're going to see perhaps more people in our congregation, people join us, be part of this, is these three things: unity. If we are united, that is a powerful witness. As long as we are not united, people out there, they hear how Ken and Helen don't talk. I'm not saying I don't talk with Helen. As long as people hear that Mike and Ken have fallen out, they don't talk. We go to church together, but we hardly talk. If people don't witness that we are united, they won't. Jesus, that was a prayer for Jesus. Let them be united that the world may know. But boy, isn't the Church of Christ just worldwide so divided? Yet we are saying, let's go and do mission, let's do this. Beloved, one of the ways to witness to this resurrected Christ is unity. So I'm asking you, what are you doing to facilitate that unity in this church? That's the first question. The other thing that I noted here, you might disagree with me, is generosity. Generosity is a key to witnessing to the resurrected Christ. How we share the things that God has entrusted us is a way of witnessing. So witnessing is not only me going out preaching, God loves you, give your life to Christ. It's being generous. Read that text, Act 4, 32 to 36. Generosity, unity, and proclaiming the gospel. No matter how beautiful we make this church, no matter what we do, if we are not united, if we are not generous and proclaiming the gospel, guys, the Spirit of the living God will not manifest in power. We will just remain a social club. So my challenge for all of us, God is not mocked, beloved. God can't be mocked. God sees my heart. God sees your heart. What are you doing when it comes to unity? What are you doing when it comes to generosity? What are you doing when it comes to proclaiming the gospel? We are all followers of Christ. We can all do something to those three things. You might not have, maybe proclaiming the gospel is not a gift or a skill you have. You can maybe do something. You can promote unity. You can be more generous. And I struggle with what I want to suggest. You don't have to do it. As I said, generosity is not here. It's not, in this text we've read, it's not that it's a command that you should do it. It has to come from your heart. It has to come from your heart. So any leader or any churches which are saying, oh, do it like that. You're doing it because someone has forced you. That's not how it's meant to be. It's meant to come out of our heart. As a church, I want us to have an opportunity to give, to some way. I just really feel, I don't know about you guys. I know you're all giving to different charities. You know, some are giving to Compassion, different. But I just wondered, as a church, if we can choose something, just give a one-off sacrifice, a one-off gift. Not to tell the treasure to remove from whatever we have. I want, if anything has touched you, as a church, say, because it's okay to listen, we always come here, but action is needed. Today I can say food bank, yes, you can get a can from your pantry, give to food bank, but I want to suggest we find a charity, be it in South America or India or Africa, just surprise them. Whoever wants, we donate. If it's a £1, we get a £10, we write to them, says, here, this is from St. Peter's in Bromyard, and leave it there. Beloved, that is part of witnessing. We can't go and do mission in India. We can't go to South America. Yes, we're supporting the foster, but guys, we can do more than that. So my challenge to all of us, if you want to, again, this is not a command. If you want to, if you feel keener, I'm happy to try and give a one-off sacrifice to that charity which we are going to agree as a church to just give up for one thing. Because, beloved, what is the point? Someone challenged me. The challenger says, Kina, you're saving up for your pension. Do you really want to die and leave maybe 100,000 in your account and die? Yes, you're thinking about your children, but what about that person in India who hasn't got a meal? Meanwhile, you're saving up for when you are dead. That was a challenge to me. There's so much that we acquire for ourselves where people are dying of starvation. Beloved, there are people who are dying where some of us have saved for a rainy day. And it's a shame, sorry to say this, our church, we've got, yes, we're saying our finances are going down, but we've got more than I don't know how much amount in our account where there is a child right now can't afford a meal. Maybe you don't know about them, but I think a lot of us, we know. There are people, guys, I know so many people literally cannot afford three meals, and I yet go to sleep every day and putting my savings aside. Shame on me. Guys, we can do better. So I'm challenging us as a church. Let us get together. Find one charity, give a one-off, because it's just not good just talking. Yes, we are united, we can get together, we can pray, But do we touch our pockets? My challenge, let our unity be demonstrated in sharing our goods. Amen.
Amen.
Father God, we thank you, Lord God. God, we thank you for your word. We recognize, Lord, that everything that we have, Lord, is a gift from you. God, you know our hearts. You know each one of us individually. God, Lord, where we have not promoted unity, we ask that you would help us to promote unity, Lord. Where we have not been generous, Lord, please, Lord, help us to be more generous. Lord, we pray individually and as a church, show us where the need is. We ask this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Now Jill's going to come and lead us in the intercessions.
The response to the prayers. When I say, Jesus Christ is Lord, the responses to the glory of God the Father. Jesus Christ is Lord.
The glory of God the Father.
Lord God our Father, thank you that after the resurrection of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, he appeared to his disciples, bringing peace and inner healing from their doubts and fears, giving them encouragement and joy. They received the gift of the Holy Spirit, who sent them out to continue the work he had begun. Some of us may have doubts and fears in this time of COVID confusion, but we pray that we will be encouraged through the truth of Scripture and stay focused on your help and in your presence day by day, that we also may be continually filled with the Holy Spirit and speak out the word of God boldly and act in obedience to his will. Jesus Christ is Lord.
To the glory of God the Father.
Lord Jesus, be the ascended one in our church, where things of little importance can distract us from the things of more importance. When our vision is small and our faith is thin, remind us again of your towering beauty reigning over all things. Give this church such a vision of your glory that nothing on earth can compare and nothing tear us away from our faith. Jesus Christ is Lord.
To the glory of God the Father.
At this time, Lord, we want to thank you for the life of Prince Philip, Duke of Edinburgh, for his dedication and fulfilment in a life of service to Queen and country, for the impact he had on many people's lives throughout the Commonwealth. He will be sadly missed. We pray for our Queen and all the royal family at this time of sadness. May they be strengthened through the love and prayers of the nation please comfort and support them to know your peace and reconciliation into a different time. Jesus Christ is Lord.
Glory to God the Father.
We pray for our members of Parliament, our scientists, all carers, and all in positions of authority. We pray, Lord, that people would be encouraged to seek your wisdom in decision making and put aside differences for the benefit of the people they serve. We thank you for those Christian MPs who chose to share the biblical truths of the Easter message online. May they continue to be witnesses and shining lights for you among their 650 colleagues. Jesus Christ is Lord.
To the glory of God the Father.
We pray for our mission contacts with Tear Fund at work in many areas under difficult circumstances, and also for our Crosslinks partners, Luke and Mary, and Barney and Martha in Santiago, Chile, experiencing yet another lockdown because of increased infections. Please keep them safe as once again they return to online teaching. May the students be encouraged in their studies and in their walk with you. Jesus Christ is Lord.
To the glory of God the Father.
And Lord, we pray for all who witness faithfully to you in churches and communities across the nation, in many different ways, often together with people of other faiths, all committed to care for others in their time of need. Mentioning here in Bromyard the work of CAP and CEM and Food Bank. We ask your blessing on those who run these projects and those who benefit from their help. Jesus Christ is Lord.
To the glory of God the Father.
Lord God, we pray that as lockdown eases, our churches, towns and villages will begin to thrive again. Help us to support each other as changes take place. Give us a spirit of openness to change and a joy in serving you, our risen, omnipotent Lord. You have set us free from divisions, and through your sacrifice may we find that deep security that enables us to be a united church family, accepting people's differences and looking to move forward on your chosen pathway for us. Jesus Christ is Lord.
To the glory of God the Father.
Give us strength to run this race. God, give us power to do the right and courage lasting through the fight. God, give us strength to see your face and heart to stand till evil cease. And at the last, O God, your peace. And together we join in the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father
in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Jill. Now, the children have been doing something over here. And I'd like to thank Julia and Paul for helping them and assisting them. And we're going to bring them out now. Can you bring your chains out? Right, we've been thinking about unity. And I was sitting the other night, actually watching the news, and I suddenly thought, paper chains. That unite, they're all united, the little loops on the chains. So they can Lady making paper chains with you on them. This is the congregation. Ready to meet up. She told me, can you find her? Where's your mum? That's her mum. Put your dad there. Oh, gosh, there she is. Very black, he is.
Yeah.
His clothes are very black. And who else have we drawn? Oh, the dog is Keena there.
Oh.
And there's Coco.
Oh.
Oh, yes, there we are. Julia, you're on it. And
who's that?
That's you, a little one, yes. Yes, so they've been really, really busy. But we've got two bits.
Mm-hmm.
We're not united, are we?
No,
we haven't got them united. So we're going to unite them with two words and make a big circle, which is what the church should be. Mm. What's the first word?
Jesus.
Jesus. And the next word is
love.
So we're going to unite our paper chain.
Amen.
With any luck. Oh, that come off, I said. Oh, dear, mum's come off and dad. Put them on again. Yeah, there we are. We've got to put them on. She's put the names too. She's bringing them. Come and look at them afterwards. She's got all the names here. There we are. Right. And they've written a verse as well, which she. More than I asked them to, so there we are. Now we're going to unite them with Jesus. So can we have your other bit? That's it. There's some blanks, because you see there's more people got to join this church yet, so some of these are blank. Let's see if we can join them together. Yeah, I think we're going to make it. Now, the other word is love, so we're going to join the bottom bit of it with love. Yep, that's it, that's fine. This is getting him straight. Right, let's put down all the energy then, shall we? And join our circle with love. There we are. So this is what we hope the church will be in the end.
Yay.
Unity.
Yay. Amen.
So what we'll do is have a hang on here. So put it on here. There we are. And thank you very much for them. No, go on there now. For doing that. So
thank
we'll give them a big
you.
Clap. For those two for helping me as well. Okay, find my glasses now. Right, now we're going to have a song. For I'm building a people of power.
Amen.
Please stand.
Thank you. sing that again.
A prayer for unity, taken from the book Keep Blessing Your Community by Jill Glover. Thank you, Lord. There is one church, one body, one Lord. We pray for the spirit of unity to be poured out upon us all. Teach us to love and appreciate the different facets of your church. Help us to look beyond our own styles and preferences. And may we know what joins us together is far greater than what separates us. Help us to recognize the beauty in our different expressions of worship. Thank you that each brings a part that the others do not have. We pray that we will work together for the greater good of the advancement of the gospel, to see your kingdom come and your will be done on the face of the earth as it is in heaven. Come, Holy Spirit, bring peace to our world. Bring peace to this nation. Bring peace to this community. Bring peace to our homes. Bring peace to our hearts. Come, Holy Spirit, come now. Amen.
Amen.
Go in faith to live in peace, united through the love of your sisters and brothers, and in the power of God's Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
And our final song. Jesus, put this song into our hearts.
Thanks for welcoming
me
to the church.
Hello.
Amen.
And you see, so often we can take for granted, but sometimes it's just to recognize someone that we welcome you.
It's nice,
yeah. We're a family.
Yeah, there's a lot of barriers with people coming to church, as you probably notice, like age and stuff like that. So it's nice to come and see it for myself. Hopefully I can introduce more people to come to the church, sort of in my sort of generation. Because
yes.
Obviously, yes. When we all sort of pass on, we've got to carry God's work on.
Amen.
So it'll be then for people like me and the next generation to do that. So if we could try and bring a few more people in, accept it, and you've been also welcome in, that'd be great.
No, we bless you. Shall we just say a prayer for David?
Yes.
Please feel free and just say a prayer out loud for David. Father God, we thank you for David. We thank you for his life and for his faith. We thank you, Almighty God, that you who knew David before he was created in his mother's womb, that, Lord God, you chose him and you called him in Christ. Lord, we bless David this morning with the presence of Jesus. We ask, Almighty God, that you would continue to lead him. You who has begun a good works in David, we pray, Father, Lord God, for your Holy Spirit to rest upon him and his family, Lord. We give you thanks and praise, Lord, for our brother in Christ. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Bless you, David.
Cheers for putting me on the spot like that.
No, sorry about that.
Thank you.
Bless you. So, beloved, may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. And go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Yeah. Oh, you want to say something? Oh, she wants to say something. Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. She wants to do it. Yeah, do it. Go ahead. Oh, wow. Oh, she wants to pray. Yes, whichever. Whatever you want. Oh my
God. Goodness. Do you want me to hold it? Yeah. Shall I hold this for you? Okay. Or let me hold the microphone for you then. God, can you make all the believers in Bromyard to be one in heart and mind? Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Oh my goodness. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God has heard that prayer. Thank you so much. That was lovely. Huh? Oh, all right. Thank you. Bye. Oh, that was lovely. Thank you very much. So she prayed that God would make all the believers in Bromyard one in mind, one in heart and mind. Thank you.